Good afternoon. I'm Claude Canizares. I'm Vice President at MIT in charge of our international engagements. So it's a great pleasure for me to welcome you all to MIT and to welcome my MIT colleagues, many of whom I see in the audience, to this forum. We're really honored to have such a distinguished group of leaders of science, technology, and education from Africa here as part of this forum. And I want to start by extending a very warm, special welcome to many of them whom you'll hear from today on the panel, but also, in the discussion. Also want to thank the organizers of this forum, the Center for International Studies, Department of Urban Studies and Planning, the MIT Africa Interest Group, the MIT Urban Africa, and a special thanks and also a welcome to my friend Calestous Juma, a professor, visiting professor at MIT. He's the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. visiting professor, and we're absolutely delighted that he took the bold step of going two stops on the red line from Harvard to come to MIT and join us. And really provide very important intellectual leadership for our thinking about Africa, of which this forum is a significant event. MIT faculty, students, and staff are passionate about tackling the world's great challenges. They are also passionate about the concept that science, technology, appropriately applied through innovation, can make a huge difference in finding solutions to those challenges. We also recognize that viable, scalable, and sustainable solutions require a close understanding of the context in which one is attempting to address those challenges. And that, of course, means that we really need to do this in collaboration, close collaboration, with those from the region who really understand the context in which we're trying to operate. And that is very much the focus of an event like this one. I know from Professor Juma and from discussions I had with some of you earlier today that Africa also has now generated a strategy that has science, technology, and innovation as a key enabler for addressing the challenges of the continent. So the timing couldn't be more perfect for an event like this to bring together those of us at MIT who are reaching in that direction and those of you from the continent who are going to help us and teach us what we need to know to be most effective in working together collaboratively with you. We see enormous opportunities, and I think this forum is will be seen in future years as a really critical point in the trajectory of our efforts in science and technology in addressing the world's great challenges. Without addressing them in Africa, we would be getting nowhere. So this is really important for us. I'm going to now turn this over to one of the leaders at MIT who has been really instrumental in helping us engage in Africa, and we have done that in many ways already in the past, and that's Professor Hazel Sive. She's professor of biology, associate dean of the School of Science, and herself a passionate leader in our engagement with Africa. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Claude. I must correct, I am former associate dean, but thank you for the honor, Claude. It is really just an extraordinary pleasure to be standing before you and to extend a further welcome to our eminent guests here. What a wonderful occasion, what a wonderful opportunity to speak, to exchange ideas, and to move forward together in our engagement between MIT and the continent. I'm South African, I'm from South Africa, and I'm from MIT. And it's been a long-term goal of mine to use those positions to bring together useful engagement between this great university that I'm so privileged to be part of and the continent, which is my home continent. I want to tell you a little bit about what's going on at MIT, because I want to not give the impression that we are not engaged with Africa here at MIT. But I want to give you a sense also that there is so much further to go and so much more engagement that we can work on together. It's really an extraordinary opportunity. There is the continent and there is our engagement. Those dots are the countries in which our faculty and students are engaged. They are kind of flashing lights. They come and go. Some of the engagements are perdurant and others are opportunistic and are there and are then not there. But the engagement, as you can see, is quite considerable. One of the things that we thought would be useful is to put together some of the programs and look at them as a synergistic set, a way to start further engagements in Africa. And so I want to introduce to you the MIT Africa program that has the goal of making mutually beneficial connections, you can read it, through research, education, and innovation. What is MIT Africa? MIT Africa is a group of programs, most of which are housed at the MIT International Science and Technology Initiative, fondly known as MISTI, a wonderful part of MIT that has many student and faculty engagements throughout the world. And really the programs that we've put together under the MIT Africa umbrella are groundbreaking, they're open-ended, and they have natural synergies that can then go very far. There are really five programs that I'll, in a bullet point of each, tell you about. Global Startup Labs is a way of communicating MIT best practices in entrepreneurship, a way of inculcating the culture of entrepreneurship that we use here at MIT far afield. We have many MIT Africa internships. I'm founding director of the MIT South Africa program, and we had a wonderful group of students out in South Africa this year working across the board in science, in engineering, in innovation, management, and so on. There are opportunities for sending more students across the continent. Empowering the Teachers is a groundbreaking program that brings top junior faculty from African universities, presently Nigeria and Uganda, and I know we have some of the fellows in the audience today. Welcome to MIT. It's such a pleasure to have you here. To develop curricula, to bring the MIT way of teaching and learning, all that problem-based learning that our students struggle with, back to the continent, to students there. The Seed Grant program through MISTI brings together faculty members who can work on a number of groundbreaking projects together and really explore future ways to engage. MITx is not housed at MISTI. It is a program that is an institute-wide program. It's really a visionary online program that brings real-time, high-quality learning that can be modularized and used to augment excellent classroom teaching. Together, these programs can be put together in ways that are synergistic and interdigitate, and where the parts together are much greater than each of the individual aspects of the MIT Africa program. As we go forward, there are so many engagements between MIT and Africa that are feasible, that are productive, and that are visionary. And it's really just a wonderful moment to be able to be part of the trajectory of the Institute forward as it engages with the continent. It's my pleasure now and my honor to introduce my new colleague, Professor Calestous Juma, to you. Professor Juma is just an extraordinary person who came into my view maybe a year ago as one of the keynote speakers at our MIT Africa Interest Group. And I realized how right here in Boston we have one of the world's great leaders on Africa. And so it's just such an extraordinary pleasure to welcome you to MIT as an MLK visiting fellow this year, Calestous. Really a great honor. And Calestous, please, now is going to work with you for the rest of this forum. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Hazel. This is a great honor for me to be here. This is my third week at MIT. Claude was right when he said that it was really a tough decision to take the two stops from Harvard to here, because the alternative was coming by boat. And I was warned that that is a little tricky, so I decided I would take the tea instead of coming by boat. I just want to really, it's a very interesting historical moment that brings together two very powerful interests. The first being MIT's effort to engage internationally with a lot of experience engaging in Asia, Europe, Latin America, and developing an interest to engage in Africa at the moment. And this is coincided with a period when African countries collectively, through decisions of the heads of state, have decided that science and technology has a role to play in long-term economic transformation, and that making efforts to learn from other countries how this has been done in the past. So the last 10 years has been really about figuring out what kinds of decisions they could adopt based on the experiences of other countries. And that's what led to the adoption of a 10-year science and technology strategy. And that 10-year strategy is part of a larger commitment on the part of African countries to develop a 50-year development program, a vision for 50 years of African economic transformation, being the only continent, essentially, that has a 50-year strategy, which gives you an indication of the optimistic view that leaders in Africa have at the moment. And within that, you have a 10-year strategy specifically on science and technology. There are three important things that underlie, essentially, this shift. One is a change in the composition of African leaders. A decade ago, you could hardly find an African president who wanted to engage substantively on the role of technology for development. Today, 15% of African presidents have a technical background. In 2012, six African countries elected engineers for president. So it's a very different conversation on the continent about how technology transforms the economy and how leaders actually view it. The second thing that also relates very much to the interest of this institution is a strong interest on the part of African leaders to put universities at the center of the development process. So we see a lot of experiments of either reforming existing universities or creating new universities that just focus on science and technology for development. A good example of that is a case of Ethiopia, which recently has established 24 new universities, all of them focused on science and technology, with a commitment on the part of the government to allocate 70% of the budget to these universities to science and technology. And there are many other experiments of a similar kind going on across the continent. So it creates this really unique opportunity for really serious engagement between a premier institution of science and technology and a continent that aspires to put science and technology at the center of its development. So what we've done, this is the focus for today, is to, we've invited people who have been at the center of that process of helping governments to decide what to do, to come and talk to us so they can share with us their own knowledge of what the priorities are so that we can hear from what Africans think about it, science and technology for development. So we have people who have really been the architects of this thinking, continuously advising leaders. And they have been here for since Sunday night, had experience of visiting classes, meeting the leadership of MIT, participating in research seminars at MIT. So they have had an experience, a bit of an experience of how MIT actually functions. So this event this afternoon is really the end of a 1-week process of engagement between African innovation leaders and MIT. So really, for them, it's been like a study tour. I can tell you that at least two of them, over these 3-4 days, I've seen them change their views on certain issues. So they have been learning already, and I'm not going to grade them now. I'll wait and see until I see what they implement. So to help us with this conversation, what we thought we'd do is I'll just invite them. Every one of you should have a two-pager which has their biographies. So I'm not going to read their biographies. I'll just invite them, and then I'm going to tell you a little bit about how we plan to run the rest of the day. So let me start with Dr. Mukhisa Kituyi, who is currently Secretary General of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, who was previously Minister of Trade and Industry in Kenya. So please help me to welcome. Yes. And Dr. Remy Kuku, who is the President of the African Academy of Sciences, a very distinguished mathematician. He's also leaving from here, going to become member of the faculty of the Botswana Institute of Science and Technology. And I think it would be a mistake if I didn't give you the proper comparison. Professor Kuku is the LeBron James of African mathematics. So please. And Dr. Beatrice Khamati-Njenga from the African Union, who has been overseeing all the science, technology, education, and youth programs within the African Union, helping the African Union to think through what kinds of collective decisions that they would like to adopt. So please help me in welcoming. So here are the ground rules. I will ask each one of the panelists to speak initially for 10 minutes. Make introductory comments for 10 minutes. And then I would like to have an engagement between you and them. That's why they have no PowerPoint slides. And so they have committed themselves to brevity. So I want to plead with you also to commit yourselves to brevity when it comes to that moment for the Q&A. And just to clarify, a question is a logical sequence of words with a question mark at the end. and so please don't try to lecture here, because there are colleagues here who really are good at lecturing. So that we can really facilitate an engagement between you and my colleagues who have pledged to brevity, and I want to plead with you also to do the same. And then at the very end, I've asked two colleagues from the African Union and the NEPAD agents, which is the implementing arm of the African Union, to give us an idea based on what they will hear from this dialogue, what they think the critical takeaways might actually be. So they are under pressure because they don't know what this team is going to say, and they don't know the questions you're going to ask. So they are going to be taking a lot of notes, and I've asked them to speak for only 1 minute. So it's going to be really interesting to see what they think the priorities are from this session. So without taking too much time, let me invite Dr. Kituyi to kick it off, please.
From here, yeah.
Actually, wherever you're comfortable with.
When I stand, my voice is easier to pick. Thank you very much, Professor Juma, ladies and gentlemen. I have 10 minutes. I didn't have the privilege of following the induction over the past few days. I'm the only one who just arrived this afternoon from the General Assembly of the UN. Two, three things, my own expectation of this dialogue. and then I can go into deeper detail. As head of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, I host the UN Secretariat on the Commission for Science and Technology for Development. I've inherited a convening power of the UN, a very, very generous mandate, but limited content on what we can do to actually use the commission to discipline development thinking and activity within the UN family. When I'm speaking in an audience, before an audience of MIT, I know your intellectual capacity and the desire to engage gives us an opportunity maybe to start a dialogue on how we can leverage your capacity, our convening power, and Africa's appetite to reboot in doing things the right way. Having said that, let me just mix up a few things I think, some coming from many years ago when Professor Juma and I started the first African think tank on technology and development, the African Center for Technology Studies. Since then, while he went on with more interesting things, I went into politics, I went into being a minister before joining the UN. Now, two, three things as trends bring me to here. The negative. In the first half of the past 50 years, Africa was investing in technology, in public universities, in schools of engineering, in polytechnics. Then sometime in the 80s, with the winds of structural adjustment, multilateral started telling Africa, you waste resources in investing in people. There are products out there which will cost you much less if you just trap the service of the product. We see a dramatic decline of research funds in public institutions. Countries like Kenya, which are doing very well in research centers for coffee, the best development of Arabica coffee through research in the world. The research in the hybrid maize, strain resistant, higher yield, drought resistant, and so on, all of a sudden disappear. You commercialize the research, and the public becomes a purchaser of the results of research. So the human resources for developing with the research disappears. Third, the collapse of public financing to university institutions. So the amorphous development of private universities. But as entrepreneurs go, private universities are easier in disciplines which require very little capital investment. So you don't build laboratories. You don't do any substantial research. You start schools of business, of law, liberal arts, and social science. So you see an overdevelopment of a product of this nature with limited linkage with the technological capacity building for the continent. Now, does Africa need science and technology innovation? Of course. How not to do it is what we've been doing more recently, which is we start looking for market access for African produce. For America, it's usually textiles. Then you say, okay, let us have a compact like Africa Growth Opportunity Act, where you have African produce getting into the American market without paying any duty. What follows? You have container manufacturing, that companies from Southeast Asia, particularly from China, send knocked down apparel finishing facilities onto the coast of Africa. They hire some Africans to cut the apparel and stitch it together, stamp it made in Kenya or Lesotho, send it to America as duty-free export, and then you statistically say Africa is increasing its export to America. And we pretend that one of the benefits is technology transfer. And the thing is, persons who sit there stitching with their sewing machines and labeling and putting into plastic bags, clothes, are hardly the conveyor of technological innovation that you can talk about. They do not, in fact, learn how to maintain the equipment they're using. Since, because of exemptions from capital gains tax, many of the manufacturers bring their containers, manufacture for 10 years, and register in a neighboring country. Even the capacity to service the machinery you've been using is taken away from the people working there. So the rituals of technology fix do not relate at all with the growing capacity for innovation that should come with manufacturing. So that's one way of how not to do it. Another thing, a driver, of course, of innovation is infrastructure. A driver of inclusive, sustainable growth, competitiveness into the world market is infrastructure. Luckily, many African countries are now getting it, that there's substantial attention to integrative infrastructure. The only infrastructure had over 50 years was the road and rail links which went from minerals to the nearest port for export. But how not to do infrastructure? You know, if I look, I was talking to him when I was flying in this afternoon, I was thinking about the construction of the first railway in East Africa. It's about almost exactly 100 years ago, from Mombasa to the border between Uganda and the Democratic Republic of Congo, because that's where the largest copper deposits are in East Africa. Thing is, 100 years ago, before the construction of the railway line, a foundry was set up for replicating the sleepers, for making the materials on site to facilitate the construction of this line. For the next 30 or 40 years, the largest investment in human resource on how to fabricate things, how to make spare parts for machines that we cannot find spare parts in the market in East Africa, was the foundry built by the East African Railways and Harbors. When I was Minister for Trade and Industry, it was under me, and I was seeing it rusting, disappearing, becoming irrelevant because of, you know, outdated technology and things, but there had been an effort. Now, fast forward 100 years, the Chinese have just started building a standard gauge railway line, which is part of an ambitious program to try to connect the Indian Ocean with the Atlantic Ocean eventually. But the first phase is through Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda. This is a very good idea. The bad thing about it, that the sleepers for this railway line are being imported from China. That local technical content in constructing a railway was much larger in 1904 than in 2014. Now, it's no time for wailing. I think it's just that opportunities are there. The infrastructure revolution that Africa needs, that the African Union has committed to, that Africa and its friends are putting resources into, should not just be the good thing because it reduces the cost of transaction, it integrates the sectors of the economies that are domiciled to the majority of the population and the traded sectors, but importantly, it should be an opportunity for a technological reboot. What components of this infrastructure can be made locally? How do we domesticate the capacity for maintenance? How do we now build a capacity that in the future, the infrastructure revolution will continue without foreign workers and technology? And these are the opportunities where the best contribution to Africa is engagement with building technical capacity to do things that normal people do in a way that scales up their activity, but also insinuates them somewhere relevantly on the global value chains that either you are on or you are not going anywhere. I'm coming to the end of my 10 minutes, and I promise that I'll try my best to keep it brief. I think we are at an interesting point, that Africa globally needs a kind of startup initiative on innovation and on science and technology. The partnership should be such that we do what everybody knows we can do. Innovators, the most brilliant people who can start creating the technical capacity to be competitive, are the cleverest people in the country. You do not take the persons who have been least competitive, who have taken the lowest level of jobs, and pretend that they're going to be the receptacle and replicators of technical competence. And that means that engagement in the workplace is important, but at the level of intellectual development, at universities, at institutions of learning, at science and research institutions, is the engine for bringing the Africans who will bring the innovation into the workplace. And that is a link we should find to create through very, very structured tripartite arrangements. The leadership of African continent, institutions with convening power like the UN, but institutions of intellectual leadership like MIT. Thank you for your attention.
Professor Kuku.
Yeah, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Juma and the MIT for arranging this interesting discussion. And we hope that at the end of it all, we will be able to arrive at some conclusions that will make MIT interact with Africa. What is science and technology? The way I understand it, it has four components made up of basic sciences, mathematics, which includes statistics and computer science, physics, chemistry, biology, and basic medical sciences. Then you have applied sciences, things like agriculture, medical sciences, energy, engineering, and so on. Then you have classical technologies, like iron and steel industry, petroleum technology, and so on. Then you have high technologies that, ICTs and so on, associated discoveries. Now, you cannot say you are developed until you have a good combination of all this. And I would like to see them as the four things as concentric structures that have the basic sciences at the innermost core, you know, from which ideas, of course, mathematics as the innermost core, the basic sciences as the inner course, from which ideas percolate to solve problems in applied sciences and technologies, and then problems arising in technologies and so on. Give rise to new problems at the inner core in the basic sciences and so on. And just for an example, somebody first asked, can you break an atom? That's a fundamental question. But whether you now, after answering that, invent bombs and so on, is another matter, you know. But it was a basic question. Or Fourier, which started by trying to observe distribution of heat waves in uneven bodies, ended up discovering what is now called Fourier analysis. That is a very powerful mathematical tool that has in turn led to many other applied discoveries. So the way I see it, some people are saying that perhaps what Africa needs is not science and technology, but technology and science. But my own submission is that whether you call it science and technology or technology and science, the idea is to be developed. And a good model for this is South Korea. I was in South Korea last month at Seoul to attend the International Congress of Mathematicians. And three leaders of South Korea told us how they made it with three 5-year development plans under a leadership, military leadership, whose daughter is now the president of Korea. So they are very focused people who knew what they wanted. And 40, 50 years ago, they were worse than most African countries. But see where they are now, a developed country. So what part of what we lack in Africa is the willpower and the political will to do things that are right. Of course, including making contacts and collaborating with high institutions like MIT and so on. So I hope that this attitude will change for the better. Now, we have in Africa, say, well, I started counting, we don't have good records, you know, but I could count 293 universities, out of which 72 universities of science and technology, of some technology of some sort. Of course, that's including the 24 that are new in Ethiopia. Now, one can say that overall we don't have much, which is true, because you go to New York area or Boston area or Chicago area, you count so many specialists and so on. But we can sort of do the best that we can with what we have. But we cannot do it alone. And that is the whole point, that many of these universities have very laudable aims, especially the ones on science and technology. You know, they want to maintain high standards. They want to be relevant to the environment and try to solve local problems and so on, which is all well and good, you know. In fact, some universities are built around local, some new generation universities, like some in Ethiopia, are built around solving local problems, which is all well and good. But in the process of doing this, I mean, if you build it around local problems, and you can generate enough ideas to create new knowledge, you know, it would be good also for our colleagues abroad to help to investigate. So either way, we need high-level institutions like MIT at the university level to, like, you know, seeing how courses work here. We have seen some since we came, and it's very impressive. And then exchange of staff and students in some ways that can be worked out and so on. Then I also represent the African Academy of Sciences, which is the Pan-African Academy that and is unique in that sense, and elects fellows and members from all over the continent. We have currently 238 members from 36 countries. And I'm proud to say that three of us in this room are members, Professor Juma and Dr. Ambali here. And there are various specialties. And ours, our own academy is more than just science. There are social scientists. There are all sorts of people. Even Wole Soyinka, the Nobel Prize winner in literature, is a member. So you can see how we interpret our science to a large extent. Now, but those examples are few. Now, the idea is that we are interested in solving Pan-African problems in a very Pan-African way. That is why we have very good relations with the African Union, African Union Commission. In fact, to the extent that they regard us as, and we regard them as strategic partners. So if you negotiate with them, you are negotiating with us and vice versa, because we are the human resources that helps to examine and try to solve the problems that are global to the whole of Africa. And in the academy, we have, how do we relate to a place like MIT? We have so many programs. It's, for instance, some of it has to do with capacity building in all sorts of areas, you know, energy, stem cell research, all sorts of areas that may sometimes be climate change, food security, water and sanitation, nanosciences, ICT, and so on, so that we are really focused on going into modern science and technology. And when we have this capacity building workshops, we get experts, not only from Africa, but from other places, high level places, where we, like Brazil, like India, like China, and some parts of Europe, you know. Now, we, and sometimes also from US, but not from MIT yet. So, what we are thinking is that with special relations with MIT, if we are organizing this type of workshops and so on, just as we invite people from other places to help and mentor and so and sort of elevate the knowledge of our youth, which who are the leaders of tomorrow for whom we're going to leave this legacy of expertise in science and technology. We can also invite people from here. And usually, some of them go out to be mentored and to work in labs abroad and so on. Well, I see that some people come here from, I've come here from some parts of Africa and so on. I happen to be a Nigerian myself, so I know that. So what I'm saying is that there are many ways in which MIT can be of value to us. People can visit to give some lectures or to interact with people and advice, you know, on how our curriculum and so on should look like. And in particular, I am now associated with a new University of Science and Technology. It's called Botswana International University of Science and Technology. This is a place, and that's the reason I'm there, that has started well, and they are very promising, and they mean business to be encouraged and molded. You know, you can't bend a tree, but if you have a young place like that, that we can all contribute to mold, there's nothing like it. I've tried to build many things before in Africa and so on, and I believe in being doing pioneering work and helping to build structures, you know. So there are many things to do there, and I will like to welcome people from MIT to help to mold this place, because the ambition is for them to be one of the best universities of science and technology in Africa and elsewhere. So there are also other universities of science and technology that MIT can relate to in many parts of the country. And we should explore all these possibilities and ensure that in trying to develop, and we want to develop genuinely. This is the point. It's not, just as South Korea did, they have shown us that it's not impossible. I mean, not all African countries can be focused, but as many of them as we can influence, you know, as African Academy of Science to be focused and move forward, we want to be able to have highly successful institutions behind us to help us mold the future. Thank you very much.
Beatrice?
Thank you. As has been mentioned, it's a very exciting time in Africa. It's a very exciting time for opportunities to engage in partnerships with African higher education and research community. And this is the time when, even at the political level, and really there's no shortage of political will in Africa concerning higher education, science, technology, and innovation, which is why there is a continental strategy for science, technology, and innovation. It's a very exciting time in Africa because now Africans as a collective are visioning 50 years ahead and recognizing that science, technology, and innovation is at the core of realizing the Africa we want in 2063. So the strategy that has already been mentioned as Science, Technology, and Innovation Strategy for Africa, STISA 2024, is a manifest reflection of this appreciation of the role of higher education, science, technology, and innovation. And this strategy is anchored in 6 priority areas to contribute to the achievement of the AU vision. These are, 1, eradication of hunger and achieving food security, prevention and control of diseases, communication, which includes physical and intellectual mobility, protection of our space, living together, building the society, and wealth creation. And The strategy also defines four mutually reinforcing pillars, which are prerequisite conditions for success. And these include building research infrastructure, enhancing technical and professional competencies and intellectual infrastructure, if you like, innovation and entrepreneurship, and providing an enabling environment for STI development in the African continent. So we do not just have a strategy that has been approved at the highest political level by heads of state and government. There are also instruments in place for implementing this strategy. And these are not necessarily new, because the intention is not to do something that will be linked to the African Union for the sake of linking to the African Union. But it takes taking into account what is happening across Africa, what we are trying to build individually and collectively. And these instruments, one of the outstanding ones is the Pan-African University, which you may have heard of. And the Pan-African University is a flagship program of the African Union. It's a university, one university in many locations. And it seeks to demonstrate quality and exemplify excellence. So rather than the process of establishing centers of excellence, where an institution, where one determines that, oh, this institution is at a particular level, therefore we will give it money to continue doing what it is doing in its little corner. But the Pan-African University sets out to exemplify excellence, meaning it is a beacon. It's supposed to influence the conduct of higher education and research in Africa. So whatever happens in the Pan-African University is supposed to trickle over into the other institutions. And also because the Pan-African University, its development, curriculum development, and all that brings together expertise from all across Africa and also from beyond. So this Pan-African University is really a very unique opportunity for engagement with African higher education and research. So it is organized into thematic areas. There are five thematic areas. One is basic sciences, technology, and innovation. Another one is life and earth sciences. The other one is water and energy sciences, including climate change. Then there is space sciences, and finally governance, humanities, and social sciences. So the way we are organized, the higher education community in Africa is organized in several different ways. One of them is thematic. So the Pan-African University is also organized thematically. So there are also other thematic associations of universities across Africa. And then we are also organized geographically. There are also regional associations of universities in Africa. And the Pan-African University, because it is supposed to be an exemplar, because it's supposed to show what is quality when we talk of quality in higher education in Africa, therefore it must needs associate with the rest of the African higher education community. To give an example, for instance, the Institute for Life and Earth Sciences. That one is based in Nigeria. It's going to, we are organizing a linkage between it and the an association of universities in agricultural sciences. There's an association called RUFORAM. So RUFORAM brings together maybe 40 universities or so, so they would be linked with this Pan-African University Institute for Life and Earth Sciences. So they would be working on challenges across Africa in the area of life and earth sciences, okay, for this particular one, in the area of agricultural sciences. So whatever you do when you partner with Pan-African University, whatever you do would have an impact across all of Africa. So the kind of research that we are looking to from the Pan-African University is, of course, something that's responsive to current challenges. So in the area, as we mentioned, the priority areas in STIZA, we need to be responsive to those challenges and provide solutions to them, but also anticipating the future. That's the beauty of 50 years. So it's not all about just today, but also about the future. At the moment also in Africa, because of the vision of the African Union of peace, integration, and prosperity, and knowing that Africa, the way higher education is, there are many different education systems, some Anglo-Saxon, Francophone, etc. So integration becomes a challenge. Mobility, academic mobility becomes a challenge. So this is also an exciting time for harmonization of curricula. So this is another area where we need partners so that curriculum is developed from the vision to what is to be done in the university, as opposed to just picking on something, maybe because it's at MIT, we can also have it in Africa. But what we can get from MIT is now the process, how to develop curricula, how to organize also delivery in such a way that we are able to nurture innovativeness, we are able to nurture entrepreneurship. Because Africa is the most youthful continent, so the young people can be, of course, a threat, but we choose to see them as an opportunity. That is why higher education, science, technology, and innovation are so important, and in particular, entrepreneurship. So we have a youth volunteer program where we identify young people who have performed particularly well in whatever field, and then we take them through some programs of awareness and place them in different international institutions so that they are able to give back to the community, but also learn to become leaders in all these different areas. And those opportunities exist also for Africans in the diaspora. And the opportunities for placement can also be exchange opportunities with young people from elsewhere. So for the Pan-African University, a lot of partners have expressed interest. There are a lot of resources. At the moment, there are a lot of resources. But of course, for the long term, we have to work on the issues of sustainability. And ways of partnering with the Pan-African University include developing new programs in those particular thematic areas. But also, we are open to visiting professorships from across the world. And I hope we will be able to welcome some from MIT. We are looking forward to that. And of course, collaborative research. The area of equipment, laboratories, that is of course a challenge. And the idea is not just to have laboratories for the sake of having them, but they have to be systems that have been proved to work well. And this is another area where we can collaborate under the Pan-African University. Let me also just say that, what else shall I say? Because we are vision-based, whatever we are doing is vision-based, so the idea of management information systems is very important, and the African Union has an observatory for science, technology, and innovation. At the moment, when you draw an innovation map, Africa tends to disappear. But this observatory, okay, it's informing us that this is what's happening so that we are now able to begin to identify the areas of need and work more to produce more in those areas. And I think with those few remarks, I'll wait to hear your responses. Thank you.
I think we have a microphone here, and I know some of you can speak without microphones. Again, let me just reiterate the importance of asking a question. Secondly, one question per customer, please. And thirdly, please don't pose a question, one question to the three of them. So let's start, Al-Fatih, please.
I found it very interesting, the remark. My name is El Tahir, and I'm here at MIT with the Environmental Engineering
program. I found the remark from the Kituyi about how the capacity for building railways declined significantly in the last century in Africa. I offer actually a counter example of how dealing with development projects would be not different. When the highest one dam was built in Egypt in the 1960s, the Egyptian government insisted that in building the dam, local companies had to be involved. And one of the local companies was a small company called the Arab Contractors that were given subcontracts to build the highest one dam. Today, the Arab Contractors may be the largest, one of the largest contractors in Africa. And so, in really building science and technology in Africa, I think there is a need that all these big development projects, when they get contracted, there has to be a component of building local capacity. And that's going to feedback into the science and technology infrastructure significantly. So my question is really to Dr. Khamati from the African Union. I mean, do you see a room for that to be included in your strategy, in your practices on how providing guidelines to African countries when they engage with Chinese or with other parts of the world in large development projects? Is there a room to require that as part of the interaction with those big companies?
So let's take a series of questions, and then I'll come back to the panel. I'm really also conscious of the gender distribution in the room, so I also want to hear from questions from the ladies before I call upon Professor Ken Oye. Any lady who wants to preempt Professor Ken Oye? Oh, yes, please. You see, I'm starting to know my colleagues around here.
Thank you for that, and thank you for the great panel we had here. My question, I'm coming from Harvard, two steps down as well, and the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative, and I've always wondered why there's such a variability within the continent of Africa of how much development in science and technology is. And I had a question for you, Dr. Beatrice, how you felt whether that difference from country to country would be able to be bridged, and how you thought we could implement policies to do so.
Thank you for the brevity. Professor Oye.
Wonderful presentations. Dr. Kituyi, the observations that you offered on kit-built assembly operations as a response to U.S. trade preferences and on the declining local technical content of railroad assembly, of railroad operations and infrastructure, are profoundly distressing. My question is, what adjustments in multilateral aid and export financing rules, and what adjustments in trade preference policies would you recommend to limit, not eliminate, but to limit these pernicious tendencies and trends?
Good question. Any more questions? Yes, please.
Hi, Mohammed Kane, a second year student here studying computer science. One question is about the way we see, about the vision of building higher education institutions. And my question is about, given the fact that we know that a big portion of the population is currently, is illiterated, how can we take that into account when planning a society where everyone basically has the opportunity of using its skill at its best, given that, for example, in a lot of countries where there have been conflict, a big chunk of the youth has not been able to have access to education. So right now, even if we build strong higher education institutions, a lot of these young people will still not have access to that, given the condition, basically because they were born a little too early, yeah.
That's a good question for Professor Kuku. I'll take a couple of more questions and then I'll get back to the panel. Yes, at the back, I have, even my enemies have joined the audience. Yes, yes, please.
Thank you. I'm in the big at my question would be, what could Africa do to create an environment that would promote entrepreneurship?
Entrepreneurship, I think Dr. Kituyi will take that. Mr. Baluch and Sola, then I'll come to you.
I'm Mr. Baluch with Africa Agribusiness Knowledge Center in Ghana. This 50-year vision that has been talked about, covering or backed up by some 56 countries, is there any role models of these countries in the continent that one can pinpoint and say they are progressing or they have made some progress towards the vision? That's the question. Thank you.
Sola?
Wonderful presentations. My name is Sola Oyinola. I work for a company called Shlomije. So, statement from what I'll mean of you here. My question is to Dr. Kituyi. Very much enjoy the historic context of the development finance. My question is, today, a major six or eight African countries have made legislation on what they call local content in a major part of the economy, which is energy development, most oil and gas. So from Nigeria to Angola to Mozambique, Tanzania, Uganda, etc. I wonder how, what kind of guidelines you can set from that historic context to prevent these kind of local content law from preventing innovation and replicating the errors of the past, so that these new big investments in energy on the continent are also the source of new innovation and employment and the investment that is required to spur ongoing development along the lines that you are wondering about.
Yes. So, question. Yes. And then Nina, and then I think we can come back to the panel.
My name is Ricardo Anderson from Oregon Institute of Harvard. I'm just wondering, I think international collaboration with African universities are very good. But I was wondering if the status of the collaboration or relationship between the universities within the African. My understanding is that if you just take, for example, University of Cape Town is highly collaborative with Harvard University as compared to, for example, Jomo Kenyatta University in Kenya. And so I just want to know, you know, the internal relationship between the universities within Africa.
Professor Kuku will take that. Let me take a couple of questions, Nina, and then the gentleman over here, and then... Then I'll come back. I'll come back to the audience.
Thank you. I'm Nina Dudnick from Seeding Labs here in Boston, and this is for either for Professor Khamati-Njenga, whichever of you wants to take it. This is a debate that I think is very prevalent in the U.S. now, which is the difference between basic research and applied research, the sort of outcomes that can be immediately applied to medicine or agriculture or what have you. And I noticed that the six pillars are very focused on development. Like agriculture, like disease. Do you think that that's the best strategy for focusing resources? Do you think that there would be merit in letting African scientists and researchers explore the entire range of ideas that they would like to do research on, that perhaps we are overly limiting our colleagues in Africa in a way that we here have had the benefit of doing research in every possible area and seeing innovation coming out of unexpected places?
Interesting. Interesting. Last question, and then I'll go back to the panel.
Thank you, Prof. My name is Bola Hon Olubowale, originally from Nigeria. It is a well-known fact that everything rises and falls on leadership. Way back in the 60s, Kwame Nkrumah built the largest dam in Ghana that was generating enough electricity to power technology and innovation in Ghana. We had a regional prime minister in Nigeria who built one of the best universities in Africa, and a couple of other technological innovations. How can we uncouple leadership from the rudiments that will drive science, technology, and innovation in Africa, and yet expect to make progress? How can we get our political leaders, the people planning and envisioning the future for us, to become fully involved in what needs to be done to move this process forward? Thank you.
Good, good. Beatrice, can I start with you? Brief comments, brief responses, and so we can have additional questions from the audience.
Okay, start with the last one. Involvement of leaders in education, science, and technology. The way the African Union is organized is that the education, science, and technology community would come and make reports to the political leadership. But what is needed more than just reports is a demonstration. We need more demonstration of the tangible benefits of STI to the political leadership so that they in turn can, you know, apart from just policy, but also invest in those areas. For instance, in Africa, a decision was taken at heads of state level to invest at least 1% GDP in research and development. But so far this has not been achieved. And I think the missing link is the demonstration of benefits to that level of leadership. Differences from country to country. Yes, there are significant, very significant differences from country to country. This is why the AU is beneficial, because it's about pulling together. Not every African country can build a world-class institution in every area of need. And it's not even necessary if they can do it together. So we are mobilizing this togetherness to be able to achieve much more than the, you know, sum total of our individual efforts, if you like. And of course, also learning from one another, positive peer pressure and all that is all part of what they get out of being a collective within the African Union. Access to tertiary education in Africa on average is 7%. Countries are as low as 2%. Others up to 40%, the world average is 27%. So with or without conflict, there was a question asked from this side, with or without conflict, there are many young people who are out of school, illiterate, semi-literate, etc. So really the strategy is not just focusing on tertiary education, but also on secondary education. So a decision was taken that the minimum education that all young people should access is secondary level education. And then of course building on TVET, technical vocational education and training, is part of the development strategy at the moment to be able to mop up the young people and inculcate that, you know, entrepreneurial thinking and skill in them. Which country is doing well in Vision 2063 is brand new. In fact, you're welcome to make your contribution until November. That's when the final document of Vision 2063 will be ready. So it's too early to start saying this country is doing better. And it's a very broad-based vision. And of course, part of the implementation, at the start of it will have to be a situational analysis, to then know who is doing well in what, and therefore learn those lessons and share them across the board.
Okay, good, thank you. Professor Kuku?
Yes, thank you very much. Somebody asked about young people not having access to education. Well, this is true in many countries. But some countries are also doing their best to motivate young people to, at least with minimum secondary education, to do other things. For instance, you know, ICT is a growing sort of concern in many developing countries, Nigeria and Africa inclusive. And you can hardly pass by any street
without seeing 2, 3, 4 cyber cafes, you know. Because a lot of these young people train themselves either to write programs, to repair computers, to do all sorts of things that will help them become entrepreneurs. And a lot of them have, in fact, made it big, you know, depending on how resourceful they are. This is why it is important to inculcate, apart from theoretical education, you know, the spirit of entrepreneurship, like MIT is doing, to see how people can use their education fruitfully to better the society. Now, talking about universities in Africa and how they connect with one another, well, we did not emphasize this here because we were talking of Africa and MIT. But there are so many networks in Africa, you know, on virtually any conceivable discipline, you know, physics, mathematics, biotechnology, and so on, you know, cutting across various boundaries in Africa. And in fact, also with help from abroad, you know, there's the Uppsala people and many other international organizations, SIDA and so on, that actually go out of their way to encourage these networks, which is very good for the university. So there are a lot of internal cooperation going on and a lot of good work being done in Africa also. You know, it's a pity that people may not know, but many universities, there are visits, you know, there are funds for one to visit one another. You know, when I used to be president of African Mathematical Union, we organized funds to make young people visit, not now North South, but South South, you know, to, if you know somebody in Cote d'Ivoire who wants to, who can do benefit you, you can get a grant from Kenya to go there and vice versa and so on. So it's not as if there are no activities going on among the universities. It is also true that many university graduates don't get jobs easily. But one way of tackling that is to diversify the training to include the entrepreneurship that the way MIT is saying.
Thank you. Dr. Kituyi, I think Professor Oya asked you a question that sends you into the jurisdiction of your competing institution, the World Trade Organization, and its rules and their impact on technological innovation. And I want to put you on the spot on that one, because being diplomatic.
Okay, the number of different things. First of all, if I may just pick up on the question of leadership that came towards the end. I have been reflecting loudly that part of the crisis of Africa is you have cyclic leadership recruitment. Sometimes we have leaders, some other times we have managers. And to me, the difference between a leader and a manager tries to be risk averse. You try to reduce the chances of making mistakes, and therefore you take very limited initiative in new directions. But leaders are ready to go to the edge, experiment with new ideas, try things that have not been done before. And managers look to the past for solutions. When faced with a crisis, how did my predecessors avoid making a mistake? And I think a good leader should be what are the best practices and what institutions of technology innovation can assist is present the models of best practice to encourage those who are leaders to run away with it. Of course, many times we generalize too much. When we say about possibilities in Africa, there's a world of difference between where the human resource development has reached in South Africa, in Kenya, in Ghana, Nigeria, and a place like Eritrea, where by law, every young man must be conscripted into the army until he's 40, which means you have no active life when you can do anything other than being a soldier. And that's why such a tiny little country in the rib of Africa accounts for nearly 1/4 of the Africans who are dying in the Mediterranean. So we cannot just generalize for all of these places. But the challenge is, can we shore up the best practices that are being attempted in some places. There are some countries which support actual best practice. In Kenya, the best science and technology institution is Jomo Kenyatta University of Science and Technology, which is substantially dependent on grant support by the government of Japan. And it has grown to be a very competitive institution. The suggestion of how to link some of these best practice institutions with other African institutions of learning is a very good idea. And I think it's one where we can build a global partnership, for example, with MIT. Can we fertilize inter-university initiatives that share a certain platform of action and engagement with governments in feeding the right people into enterprise? Now, two things that were mentioned I'll talk about. One, any case of supporting entrepreneurs, yes, they exist. The country I come from has now, by law in Kenya, public contracts, at least 30% of all public procurement contracts must go to companies belonging to younger persons, meaning people below the age of 35, and women. That's an important step forward. It needs assistance to use that content, because what can happen is if you do not develop the entrepreneurship among the youth, they take their allotment and sell it. All right. That's the same with that which was mentioned about countries we protect local content. Actually, it's not always local content. It's about local participation. But local participation, again, if it does not have the technical competence, the innovativeness to reduce costs, to be competitive, ends up being subcontracted to an external source and subverts the original principle, which wanted to grow domestic capacity. So to my mind, more transparent utilization of the space being created by law and practice, and greater infusion of investment in science and technology creates a backbone along which you can now grow the local content. I am one of the people in the UN system who are arguing there is a major weakness in international investment and bilateral trade agreements, which stunts technical innovativeness in developing countries. And what South Africa has done is very interesting. They have announced a sunset clause that all bilateral trade agreements between South Africa and other countries for the past 50 years will expire at a certain date. So you are invited to start negotiating with us the new regime of investment agreements. The era of desperation where you gave away even the soul of your ability to grow is over. Even for infrastructure, we can say we need infrastructure, but we cannot end a bad agreement. Nobody forces you to sign those agreements. You can slow down the agreement, but commit to a certain local component, content. And my desire is, can we grow the lever of international solidarity, innovativeness, invest in the growth of African entrepreneurs who are also innovative, who are scientifically up to date, who look for the best practices, while also looking at policy space to utilize that in order to domesticate that innovativeness among the Africans, to resuscitate it, because it has been in decline over this period.
Great, thank you. I have 5 minutes. Why does it always happen like this, that when I have 5 minutes, and then there are 10 hands going up? Dick? Yes? And by the way, you can ask a question for which you don't need an answer. That will save me some time.
This has been a fascinating discussion. But I think one of the reasons is you're here at MIT is to talk about what MIT and Africa can do together. So let me ask a hypothetical question. Say that $50 million or $100 million were available for one project, one specific project. And I'll ask any of the three panelists to ask, what would that project be? It has to be very specific and focused. I'd like to hear your answers to that.
That's a very good question. I would like that question to be answered by Aggrey, Ambali, and Masheleni, because their job is to think about what to do next. Don't look down, I'm looking at you. Yes. Yes, please.
Well, I know that this is an issue for a lot of countries, and everyone kind of thinks about this, but when you graduated from school, the idea of the country is to keep that person there to work in the country and benefit the country. And so I'm wondering how you're getting people into jobs right away once they graduate, or even bringing people from other countries to help work on all these great innovative ideas.
Is that your wife calling? Yes, Libby.
Yes, thank you so much. I was fortunate to go to the meetings around the African Leaders Summit in Washington on science with the National Academies and the American Academies. And I've been fortunate the last day to go to the University Industry Demonstration Partnership meeting. And one of the things that's become very clear to me is the key role that industry and universities play in driving innovation. And so it's sort of a question, but also some potential best practices, or making sure we invite Africans to a meeting like that so they understand it. But how do you do that and yet make it your own? One of the messages that came through at these meetings with the National Academy was that Africa is going to put its own stamp. It's not about us telling you what to do. You have your own expertise, your own wisdom, and you need to take it and get what you need. And how are you going to do that with MIT? What are the anchors in your core values that are going to really shape this relationship?
Good question. Libby has just started a new job at the National Science Foundation. Thank you for coming. John? Back.
Yes, my question is posed really to both the UN development as well as African Union.
No, direct it to one person, please.
All right. To Dr. Kituyi. My question involves, from an investor's perspective, I'm wondering about any collaboration that you envision between the academic science, technology, and innovation community and country investment promotion centers. And my example is, we have invested in Ghana in agribusiness, and I'll speak specifically just for 10 seconds. It's about seed and what kind of seed innovation is needed from an investment perspective. And we wanted to come and test wheat varieties, and there was a very difficult time getting approval, and we wanted to bring in not two varieties, not 10 varieties. We wanted to bring in 500, 600, 700 varieties to have a culture of innovation and experimentation. So I'm wondering about, from a collaborative perspective, the way the Academy maybe is working with country investment centers, government-sponsored investment centers, to create, to the previous question, this industry academic collaborative that will help the flow of investment capital into Africa.
Thank you. I think I'll take a last question here because I'm new at MIT, and the last thing I want to do is my first public appearance. I'm insulting the hospitality of the institution by going overtime. So last question. And then I'll go to the panel to use the opportunity to make closing comments. And then I will ask our colleagues who work on the implementation aspects of African Union and NEPAD to answer Dick's question of the $100 million question.
Well, thanks for the pleasure. My name is Yi Ting. I'm a researcher from Yale, probably 10 steps down the road. My question is also for Dr. Kituyi. I'm wondering if you can maybe name a few working models for technology transfer, and boasting the history of North-South collaboration and South-South collaboration that's sort of on the rise. Just given I think the long history of failures and the supermarket of technologies that was developed in the 50s and not working, I think, so well from that perspective.
Good. Do you want to start with that?
All right. Thank you very much, everybody. If I may just start with the last question. First of all, one of the impediments of technology transfer globally is the dilemma between development and intellectual property rights, protection of patent and things. And if you see one of the ways countries have developed, it's either they temporarily just breach the intellectual property requirements, and you know more than enough examples of that, or industrial espionage, or open source technologies that are available at national policy text in. So at one level, the mover, the demander is the national leadership of a country involved. But you see, this is assuming a developmental state where there is a passion, an agenda, and a commitment to certain forms of development. Scaling up learning. A few months ago, I was visiting with President, with the Prime Minister of Cambodia, Hun Sen, who ended the rule of Khmer Rouge. And he was very passionate when he was talking to me. For more than I know, he was just saying, look, I inherited a country where the Khmer Rouge, when they were in power, they made it a national ideology to kill all university graduates. So a large country didn't have anybody with a university degree. That all Cambodians with degrees were in exile or in the grave. Land rolls and everything had been muddled up. But what we did is say, there is enough to learn about around the world and to emulate and catch up with them. And our model step by step was say, let's try to do what Thailand is doing better than they do it. And next to say, let us see where we are going to be competing with others. But he said, many countries don't notice it. And I like this if you ask me about what to use the money on. He said, the first thing we have to do is to believe that we cannot industrialize unless we industrialize food production. And so he fast-tracked making Cambodia competitive even compared to China, South Korea, and Thailand in quality rice production. And then the technology can spill over into other areas. And he kept emphasizing, grow your entrepreneur, grow your enterprise or possibilities. Okay. If you gave me money today to put into one single thing in Africa, I will take Pan-African institutions to set standards and grow quality regional institutions for research in biotechnology and the fight against hunger. If Africa can feed itself, it will have the health and the technical competence to start doing other value-added activity. But the moment we destroy the ability to feed itself, I think we eroded a critical benchmark necessary to innovate. But that is answering to a second question. We have a dilemma that is not adequately talked about, and even just an open academic exercise, I will be talking about it. The dilemma of democracy. All models of developmental states which have made it national policy to try to drive progress had some form of benevolent dictator. If you go to Africa today, yeah, there are no models in Southeast Asia or Africa where we have seen recent progress without some benevolent dictatorship. Even if you look at what's happening in Ethiopia, what has been happening in Rwanda, they have certain legroom that more democratically developed countries do not exercise. I was telling somebody that in places like Kenya, even just to incubate an idea of a global national level, you fall into problems of the push between resources at national level and the devolved government as the implementers of developmental ideas. You fall into all manner of democratic traps that slow down things you cannot do as well as South Korea did it historically, or Lim Kuan Yew did it in Singapore, Ethiopia started doing a few years ago. Ethiopia is moving very, very dramatically. But it will be caught up with the democracy trap after a short while. Our democracy, we imitate the worst of what the West could do. We almost have a situation where you don't trust your neighbor, and to take a letter to the post office, you have to set up an inter-party committee. What can we do at the level of MIT, Africa, and UN? I come from the UN side, but I also have a passion for my African identity, my desire that Africa succeeds. I have the convening power of the United Nations as host of the secretariat of the only organ in the UN dedicated to science and technology for development. Now, one of the things we've done for five countries, is to do national science and technology policy review. Now, we can end an arrangement where we raise the benchmark of what should be the prescriptive work of national reality check on science and innovation. we can have a standard substantially influenced by the practical experience of MIT on what should be the prescription that we should be putting on the table for Pan-African initiative, for regional initiative, for government initiatives. And I'm very much interested in looking at how we can explore that. I'm aware that we might be having another session after this where we can go more deeply into this, but I'm also available to keep coming back to this, to invite you to engage more directly with our commission. We can even have a partnership on that to help us be more realistic, but also use the policy space available to make a fundamental impact on how STI can drive Africa's renaissance.
Just for the record, Dr. Kituyi was a leading figure in the pro-democracy movement in Kenya in the late 90s and early 2000. got elected, beat one of the most prominent ministers in Kenya, popular vote. I'm not so surprised that he has revised his views because... So can I plead with you to make some really just very short closing comments so that we can get our two colleagues to answer the $100 million question?
Okay, my first closing comment has to do with what somebody asked about the role of academics or academies and industries. And I want to seize this opportunity to mention what platform, a very big platform that the Academy of Science, African Academy of Science, is onto now, bringing together people like Bill Gates, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Wellcome Trust, DFID, and so on. These are big companies that look forward to getting results quick they can use for other purposes, but setting up African Academy of Science as setting up a platform with African Academy of Science and involving many other companies that hope to benefit from the type of research that the academy can commission. So this is at the academy level, but the academy is going to use university people to do this research and work on the various problems that different companies and industries are interested in. And in Africa also, we get questions from industries rooted through the academy that academy gets its members to solve. And lastly, I think that the value of any academy is to get its members to collaborate. For instance, with South Korea, I was in South Korea last month. One of the things I negotiated with the president of Korean Academy of Science and Technology was a bilateral symposium between our academy and CAST. Next year, we are hosting them for a two-day bilateral symposium in biotechnology and biosciences. The next year, we are going to Korea to have a bilateral symposium. The way it works is whoever is hosting dictates the topic and the summit. So what I'm trying to say is that just as we are trying to work out something with MIT as an institution, we also have relations with other places, either as researchers or as academies and so on, that helps to promote research on our continent in many ways. So these are the type of things I say that if we look closely, maybe there are areas where we can collaborate. Thank you.
Beatrice?
Let me just say one of our challenges is making African higher education and research more attractive, so that even as we produce, you know, the intellectual capital, if you like, after they are trained, that they will be happy to work in Africa. But not just that, but also attracting others from out here to African institutions. So of course, one of the things we need to do is invest in the research infrastructure to build the quality and therefore make it more attractive, but also collaborating with institutions like MIT. It means that you can return home and work, but you still have, you know, a link with the high-level laboratory facilities, if you like, of other countries. Then focusing research to vision as opposed to leaving it open. As you have heard, we must feed our people and we must, you know, do it in more efficient ways. So definitely we must have research that is focused on that vision. But that does not mean that scientists are not allowed to push the frontiers of knowledge. But I would say the balance would be towards being responsive to the needs while at the same time, you know, seeking to push the frontiers of knowledge, but as number two rather than number one for the time being. Having a vision towards which we are working as Africa and operating multilaterally helps to strengthen, if you like, our bargaining capacity when we are discussing partnership with other agencies, or whether they be donors, industry, and other institutions. So the fact that we have a collective vision, if we are sold onto it, then we are less likely to be influenced in many different directions that are not attractive. And this is the way it has been for a long time. I mean, being influenced that some institutions will be doing research based on what the partner wants or what a donor wants to fund. But now, because we have a collective vision, we have a clear strategy, we have even instruments, so it should be easier for us now to be able to influence partnerships appropriately so that it's a win-win situation and not always the other way around.
Wonderful. Can I ask you, Professor Ambali and Masheleni, to you have 1 minute to spend $100 million. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. My name is Aggrey Ambali. I think this has been a very lively discussion, and I appreciate the contributions. Much as I'm supposed to spend 1 million 1 minute. I think what has come out from the panel members here is the fact that I think the areas of concentration have been identified. I mean, she did identify 6 areas that the continent has identified as key areas, and indeed, he emphasized the issue of food security and what have you. Now, I think for MIT Africa Partnership, you see that in each of those areas, be it environment, be it space, be it food security, be it health, first and foremost, we need technologies. Now, how does MIT partner with Africa in terms of actually establishing relevant technologies that can deliver on those areas of interest? Now, I think what is coming out from the discussion here is the fact that in those technologies, we should be mindful of 2 things. Probably one, and that is increasing local content in terms of materials that go into those technologies, as well as infrastructure, as well as increasing local content of expertise in those. Now, you see, that, first of all, takes you into all sorts of sciences, as well as now brings in the issue that I think Mr. was talking about, curriculum development. And that's where the education now comes in. How does MIT and Africa and institutions team up to develop relevant technologies for delivering on those priority areas? Now, I don't want to give the impression that Africa is on the receiving end. No. There are good brains on Africa, within as well as outside. The question is, how do we partner? Now, the other area, in the course of you delivering on any of those thematic areas, is how do we build on the best practices that we have so far achieved in the area of entrepreneurship. And I think this is an area that MIT would actually find a niche to partner with Africa. And the other area, I think, starting from the first speaker, was the area of policy alignment and also fighting policy misalignment. I was quite impressed here for the two, three days I've been here, whereby behind engineering, behind the life sciences, there's an issue of the policy dimension to it. And that speaks to what I think came up from the speakers of the fact that science is not just science on an island. Science has to be carried out within a community of physical as well as other sort of environment. So I think it's still a matter of picking up on an agenda and trying to say, how do we fill in here in a collaborative manner? Thank you very much.
It's not lost on me that you ignored the $100 million question, Masheleni.
Thank you very much, Prof. My name is Ambali Masheleni. I'm coming from the African Union Commission. I will give my intervention very briefly. The first point is we have already been given the background that MIT and Africa are not starting to collaborate today. There is a lot of collaboration that has already been initiated, and this provides a breeding ground for us to scale up the technological ability of MIT and the various interest areas that technology can be applied to in Africa. And in the very opening remarks by the Vice President, he mentioned the fact that there is a need to understand the people with those problems so that they can benefit from the solutions that are going to come out from the collaboration. So one of the most important things is to realize that the collaboration has been there, and we have a huge opportunity to scale up that collaboration by bringing in a new dimension that is brought about by what Beatrice has said, that Africa has brought together its 54 countries and defined a strategy that has been adopted by its heads of state. And it identifies not only socioeconomic problems for Africa, but most of them are also global and are of concern to MIT and can be solved by the available technologies. So that is very important to take home. The other important point has been the fact of rebooting Africa, that in the rebooting Africa, there is also a need for us as Africans to look at what has worked and what has not worked, what has caused the declines, and how can we avoid that as we move towards the development of our capacities and our technological ability. So that is very important to us. Now, coming to the $1 million question.
In less than a minute.
The first answer to that question is, the person who asked this question, I would also like to know what he thinks, if I put $100 million there, how does he think he can collaborate with me? That's the first question. That's the first answer. The second answer is, in an environment of collaboration, the most important thing of a healthy collaboration is to bring the benefit of that collaboration to the people who matter in the collaboration. In this case, I think of creating strong education, research, and innovation space between MIT and Africa as a model that allows the key beneficiaries, the scientists, the universities, to have access to that funding so that they solve the problem that we would have identified at a political level. Thank you.
I would like to close by saying that if you gave me $100 million, I would spend it on online education. And I would spend it really quickly. So let me invite you to really thank our panelists really for coming a long way and being able to share with us their vision for the continent. I apologize for the fact that we went over time, so please let's give them I really want to recognize the people who have worked really hard to make this happen. Where is Michelle? Michelle is not here. Julia? I just want you to really join me because there's a team that has been very effective in getting this important meeting convened at the shortest time possible. Michelle, I'm sure, is out there making sure that you can have the reception. So Michelle, Julia, and the rest of the team, please, let's give them a big hand.